This week on Bay Area Artist Honors Fallen Soldiers.
I noticed that all the families look in the eyes, and I make that little piece perfect.
Celebrating 100 years of the Houston Ship Channel.
So this exhibition is really about giving voice to the men and women who work along the Ship Channel.
Alternative architecture at the Blaffer Museum.
Bildering is about urban ascent, about climbing structures, taking death-defying photos.
Bollywood shines in the Sunshine State.
Because very often we can accomplish things artistically and culturally that we can't politically.
And one gallery's unlikely employee.
We have a full-time resident who is the most popular staff member in the building. His name is Dart.
I'm Ernie Manoos, and it's time to get shipshape on Arts InSight. Welcome to Arts InSight. In honor of Veterans Day, we're coming to you today from the only floating museum in Houston. We're at the Battleship Texas, the first battleship memorial museum in the United States. We'll tell you more about the ship and let you know how you can visit in a few minutes. But first, we're going across the Ship Channel to Baytown and the studio of artist Ken Pridgen. After a career painting billboards, Ken found a calling that honors soldiers who have fallen in the line of duty.
I was a sign painter, did billboards for many years. That's where I got my nickname of the Dauber. So I'm Ken the Dauber Pridgen. July the 12th, 2010, I was given a call to paint a portrait of Wesley Riggs. He was from the Baytown area. And so I said, I'll go and I'll sit outside City Hall and I'll paint it. And someone tapped me on the shoulder and says, you're gonna have to paint a portrait of Jesse Ainsworth, who was killed in Afghanistan a few days before that. A lady called me later when I was working on that because she heard that I was putting the stories in the background of the kids. And she said, my son was a football player and a bull rider. Can you put that in? And I said, yes, ma'am, we'll try that. I started looking at the epitaphs, reading the epitaphs of the kids, you know, every time I would get a request to paint one. I would ask the family to give me a little history on them. They tell me some stories about their childhood, and if he was a football player or if he had a four-wheeler that terrorized the neighborhood or whatever, and I put that in the background. I just composed that painting, every bit of it, and then I start painting.
Michael was born in Hawaii on August 11, 1986. He was 15 years old when 9/11 happened, and it kind of stuck in his mind. He was deployed on 1 August 2006 to Iraq. Memorial Day weekend, we were notified of his death. He spent Mother's Day with us, and my wife said, you know, that's the most wonderful gift that she could have received.
I noticed that all the families look in the eyes, and that's what I work on, and I make that little piece perfect.
He had been in the Navy for, I guess, about 4 years or so,
yeah.
And he decided he wanted to be a Navy SEAL, so he went into training, and that's when he passed away in drown-proof training.
The eyes are perfect. He had those bright blue eyes.
I've painted over 150, and now We don't have any room in here, okay, anymore. I've painted myself into a corner, and I painted the corner somehow, and I painted myself out on the street. My vision is not just to have a building here. My vision is to have Portrait of a Warrior Memorial Art Gallery all over the United States.
He was the quiet, strong type. His buddy said that whenever he talked, everybody listened because he was either going to say something so profound or so funny that they'd be rolling on the floor. He was killed August the 18th. And Philip was 22 when he was killed.
People ask me, well, what are you going to do, Ken, when the war ends? I said, man, I'm going to get out in the street and celebrate with everybody. What are you talking about? This war has lasted too long.
It's such a blessing to for him to do this, you know, because it means a lot to the parents.
I've had 30-minute hugs from families. Once one of those families hugs your neck and tells you how appreciative they are, you're done. That's it.
Each one of these young men and women have stories, and their lives have affected umpteen people, each one of them. It's important to see their faces. They belong not just to us, but to the nation.
To find out more, visit portraitofawarrior.org. Welcome to the Battleship Texas. Commissioned 100 years ago this year, she was a veteran of both World Wars before retiring here on the Houston Ship Channel. So here to tell us more about the ship is Andy Smith. Hello there, Andy.
Hello. How you doing?
Well, thank you for having us here.
Glad
First question,
you.
should we need her? Could she go back in and fight for us?
Sadly, she could not. When she was given to the state of Texas by the U.S. Navy, they deactivated her engines and her guns. So she couldn't move or fire, and without those two features, she's not real effective.
But she's great for us to have right here, and the importance of having the ship here, do you think?
She served in both World Wars, World War I and World War II, so it was an epic monument to the service of the men and women that served the state of Texas and the United States, and it's just an amazing resource to have right here in our backyard.
And the beauty of it is she came out of service and within 2 years was here for us.
Absolutely.
And now is a museum, so people can come through.
Absolutely. And she was the first Memorial Battleship Museum in the nation. April 21st, 1948, she was decommissioned and recommissioned as the flagship of the Texas Navy.
So, when people come to see the ship, there's various ways they get to move through here and get to experience the ship. What are some of those?
The most common one is to do a self-guided tour, just wander around the ship and experience it. We try to present the ship as if the sailors just walked away for a minute. So we try to immerse the visitor into an experience. But there are a number of other ways. We have an overnight program, mostly scouts and youth groups.
I want to hear about that. So you get to spend the night on the ship?
Absolutely. You get to swab the deck, spend the night, do all kinds of activities. The ship's yours for the evening, more or less. It's a great program put on by the Battleship Texas Foundation, our private nonprofit support organization, and they do a great job. Lots of kids come through here and really enjoy it. That's a great experience. We also do hard hat tours throughout the year, especially in the cooler months. We do an in-depth, behind-the-scenes tour of the battleship. It takes you into places that aren't open to the general public. You get a much better feel for what it was like aboard. So it's amazing piece of history, and the thing we tell people is if you want to see some of the most important, significant battles in the U.S. in world history, you can go to D-Day, you can go to Normandy Beach, you can go to Iwo Jima, or you can come here, because the men who served aboard here, this was their battlefield. This is where they served. She hasn't changed.
Veterans Day coming up.
We kind of consider every day Veterans Day out here, so we let the veterans of the ship on board free anytime, and we give discounts to military and veterans. And we try to celebrate them every day.
Well, it's great. It's wonderful that it's here. A wonderful piece of history. And thank you guys so much for preserving it.
Thank you. You're welcome. It's our pleasure. It's a great task to undertake, for sure.
As we mentioned, Battleship Texas sits on the Houston Ship Channel and Buffalo Bayou. The Ship Channel is also celebrating its centennial this year as a deep water port. A new exhibit at the Julia Ideson Building downtown celebrates the people that helped make the port and the city of Houston a success.
One of the things that attracted me to the Ship Channel and to the Port of Houston was its vastness. It really is an amazing entity, very organic, and yet involving literally hundreds of thousands of people. Stories of a Workforce is really a departure from most treatments of the port and the Houston Ship Channel, because most of them look at the history of an institution. And those are important things, but none of it would exist without the people involved in making those institutions function. So this exhibition is really about giving voice to the men and women who work along the Ship Channel and are the essential element in making it happen, but who are completely unheard in most histories and renderings of the port or the Ship Channel.
My dad and my uncle had a marine transportation company. They owned tugs and barges, and they operated out of Houston in the Gulf and foreign flag vessels. I started in the repair business myself in 1998. They call it getting salt water in your veins, and you somehow can't get it out. Every day is different. Ships are like little cities. They've got every kind of system in them that any city would have. And so they're incredibly complex. They have to support people, they have to move products, and they have to survive in a saltwater corrosive environment.
The exhibition is organized around themes that were really common in the interviews. We look at families, we look at communities, we look at the importance of know-how and knowledge and how that's changed. We look at the struggles that the workforce has gone through over the last, in particular, 50 years. We had to create a space where we really could evoke the environment of the Ship Channel as much as possible. So literally, we built out a boat because we wanted people to have a sense of what it was like to mount a vessel and what it was like to sort of stand at the helm. We wanted to use large photographs in many instances because of the scale of the work that people do and the scale of the setting. It is the Houston Ship Channel. It's 52 miles long.
Port of Houston is one of the more challenging ports in the United States with the amount of traffic we have here.
The audiovisual installations and the audio installations are essential to that whole notion of really not telling the story through our voice, but through the voices of the people themselves.
My name's Steve Bennett, and I started tying up ships in 1977. I've been doing this job now for 37 years. The boats I started back 37 years ago were wooden boats, and I like to say it was when boats were wooden and men were steel. I wore a cowboy hat and cowboy boots down on the docks. Nowadays, I have to wear hard hats, life jacket, have a radio with me, steel-toed boots on. A lot of stuff has changed.
The Biggers painting that's part of the exhibition is one of the great surprises. I knew it had been commissioned by an ILA local. The ILA is the International Longshoremen's Union. So I just started calling. And I found T.L. Simon, who is the president of ILA 24, and he said, sure enough, it's right here in our union hall. It's an incredible piece. It was commissioned in 1957 by ILA 872, which was an all African American ILA local at the time. And so it's a document, it's an homage that Biggers created, really tracing the history of black labor on the port in relationship to the longshoremen.
And to show the new workers that was coming into the industry, progression from the old days up to now, to modern times, as far as that mirror goes. Thank you.
And Stories of a Workforce, the exhibition as a whole, celebrates that human contribution and gives voice to the people who have built, maintained, and continue to make the Ship Channel happen and be this amazing entity in our city.
Stories of a Workforce will be on view through January. The exhibit is part of a months-long celebration of the Ship Channel and the East End called Transported and Renewed. And you can learn more at transportedrenewed.com. Up next, creative reuse of our built environment is the subject of a new exhibit at the Blaffer Art Museum at the University of Houston.
Steve Maticio. I'm the curator at the Contemporary Arts Center in Cincinnati, Ohio, and I'm the curator of Bildering, Misbehaving the City. Bildering, in its purest form, is an offshoot of parkour, which has now become more widespread as the sort of urban form of acrobatics. Bildering is about urban ascent, about climbing structures, taking death-defying photos, and I wanted to look at 23 contemporary artists that we're looking at the city in new ways, this idea of misbehaving the city, stepping outside of intended and assigned function to open up both the physical and psychological possibilities of the city. So one artist that I think really encapsulates the character and spirit of Bildering is an artist named Lee Walton, who is an American artist typically grouped under the umbrella of social practice or performance art, but he describes himself as an experientialist. And so he has a pair of works in this show, one called Making Changes, where he very casually walks into and out of a video frame and makes small incremental changes to the city environment. So whether that's taking a bunch of bananas out of a box and putting them in with apples, or flipping up a large iron wheel and allowing it to roll into the street, he does this in a very sort of nonchalant but incremental way, in that he's creating this sort of manifesto of the everyman. He's turned the city into his canvas. And by making these small changes, it's almost like an author switching around sentences in a book. You're gonna have a larger but very surreal meaning to what you originally thought you understood. And one artist who I really think speaks the spirit of Bildering is a young German artist named Sebastian Stumpf. And he's got two pieces in this show, one called Underground Garages and one called Bridges. And Sebastian is this, if this is even possible, a nonchalant daredevil. So to give you an example with garages, he finds all of these slowly closing garage doors that we would typically experience in the city, but rather than just letting that opportunity pass, he takes a running start and barrels under it like Indiana Jones invading a new kingdom. And he increases the drama that much more in the sister piece, Bridges, when he starts to literally jump off the side of bridges into the water below. And we don't see him come up. You're never right sure. There's this moment of anxiety when he disappears, and then you're waiting for the next vignette when he reappears. But there's very little showmanship to it. It's not about him high-fiving his cameraman and showing himself off. It's really about almost laying down a template for us not to do it in that dramatic a way, but to step outside of the path, to step outside of that particular walkway, and to reimagine what the city can be when we sort of take ourselves out of our particular physical ways of navigating the city. What psychological possibilities can that open?
The exhibit runs through the beginning of December. For more info, go to blafferartmuseum.org. Up next, from Bildering to Bollywood, bringing its unique glamour and glitz stateside for a festive gala in Tampa, Florida.
I think the brand, the IFA, that made us come all the way from India here.
Every year, IFA chooses a new host city in a different country to hold its award show. This year, Tampa was chosen to host, making it the only city in the United States to do so.
Yes.
IFA events took over Tampa for 4 days, ranging from the IFA Expo to the main event, the awards show. The IFA Expo brought the vibrant magic of India to America through customary food, entertainment, dress, and jewelry. Thousands of spectators came to the green carpet to get a glimpse of their favorite Bollywood stars.
IFA Award for Best Performance in a Leading Role, Male, goes to...
The so-called Bollywood Oscars presents awards in artistic and technical excellence to professionals in the Indian film industry.
So I'm Miss America, that was my talent, so I grew up watching Bollywood films.
Celebrities from India and the United States attended the IFA Awards show, bringing glitz and glamour to the green carpet. Several celebrities share their perspective on the Bollywood industry and the award hopefuls.
It just feels very unreal, yeah, because for any actor to crack that first film is very tough, of course, and that is like a dream. And then on top of that, once you crack it, people like it. Getting nominated for IFA, I think it's just like, it's beautiful.
I hope we can do justice and entertain this amazing humanity which has turned over today. And I also see a lot of local citizens and fellow Americans, and so I hope they like the show and they bite into the Indian movies a bit.
I think it's the right time. That the timing is very right, and it's, you know, it happened. I started off Slumdog Millionaire, and I think somewhere they started taking notice that, you know, the film had an entire brown stock cast.
Valuable, and it's great, and it's important, and the fact that I'm here tonight to welcome IFA to the United States makes me feel like, you know, that's what we should be doing, bring our cultures together, because very often we can accomplish things artistically and culturally that we can't politically.
It's been an amazing 4 days. I think in the short term there's going to be an economic infusion of capital, but in the long term, to establish relationships with India, with the Indian film industry, with Indian corporate leaders, will pay dividends for decades.
The IFA events infused Indian flavor into Tampa Bay.
For more, visit IIFA.com. Finally tonight, the Dublin Arts Council in Ohio is home to some fine artwork, numerous public installations, and one unlikely employee.
You know, we don't say welcome to Dublin Arts Council, we say, are you allergic to cats? In the building itself, we have a gallery series, we have classes and camps over the summer. And then outside the building, we have a concert series, and we have a plethora of public art. Yes, we have a full-time resident who is the most popular staff member in the building. His name is Dart. Dart is a stray that sort of came to us through one of our staff members. The story is he was living on a farm and not getting along with the rest of the cats. So we received a call from Pennsylvania, and they said, you know, would you consider the cat? So of course the staff came to me and said, you know, there's this cat, and could we possibly, you know, take the cat as a, you know, gallery cat? So I agreed, and you know, the cat just sort of won us over. Well, he attends all meetings, if he can. And it's always meetings where you have lots of papers on the desk or on the table. Hands down, he'll be there and he'll lie right on the papers. He just sort of dispels the elite sort of sense of the gallery and the Arts Council. He just sort of brings it down to a level where, okay, I'm comfortable here, This was an old home. You know, it just happens to be a gallery where there's art. It's something to talk about other than, oh, there's a grant due or we're not going to meet budget this month. It just sort of brings it all down to some sort of a calm take on the world.
For more on Dart's home, visit DublinArts.org. And that's a wrap for us tonight. Join us next week when we meet Amir Taghi, an up-and-coming Houston designer who recently showed at New York's Fashion Week, and he's only 18 years old. For all of us here at Houston Public Media, I'm Ernie Manous. Thanks for watching, and have a great week.